Welcome to another session with Whiteboard Trails. I'm Shanmukh here. Today we have Madhivan and Rajendran, who is the producer from Stray Film Factory and who was a theater actor before, and he has worked as a UI consultant across the globe, alongside which he has started Stray Film Factory, and that was in 2015. Can you provide us some background with respect to your production company, and when did you choose to start, and how did you venture into film production from theater?
First of all, thanks for having me, Shamnok, and everyone. It all started off actually with a theatre company. So Stray Factory initially was a theatre company, and we were doing a lot of shows in and around Chennai and traveling with that. Over a period of time, of course, when the digital wave hit in 2014, and people were, online creators on YouTube were becoming a big thing. That's when we started a YouTube channel as well. And I think one of the videos that we had out, which is our first video, We Are South of India, was a very popular video at the time. And from there, we realized the power of video to be able to, tell more stories. So we started the YouTube channel, and that lasted for about 3 years. But over a period of time, we also felt like, having the theater connection, wanted to tell more deeper stories that, theater allowed us to do. And that was the transition to independent film, really. And since then, though, a few things have changed. So, of course, while Stray Factory continues, I recently took on a new role with the company called Story Culture Company. And here we are trying to make films which are native for global, which basically make films from South Asia to an international market. And Stray Factory largely is being handled by two other producers, Drishya Gautam and Tarana Reddy right now.
Now that you're saying that you're making these films that are very local to a global audience, how's it like, and what is the conversation that happens around when you're trying to make a local film for a global audience?
Okay, so I guess, I mean, we have been, of course, fortunate enough that we are at least in India or even within some of the states also, we are sort of self-sufficient, right? Like, if you look at a Tamil film or a Telugu film, it is self-sufficient for the greater part within the state itself. But now, of course, we start exploring how a film can have dubbing rights in another state, and now slowly those kind of conversations have become very important. And now it's added to the the final finance of the film. In fact, just the other day I was walking around, I saw a Vijay film completely dubbed in Hindi, and people were watching it like with full gusto. So I was like, okay, so obviously there's a huge change and huge market for all of these things. So similarly, like that, I think now it is time for us to tell stories which can truly reach even larger audiences, like in outside of the country. And I think first we should look at probably South Asia itself. There are so many connecting themes between India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, even Pakistan, Afghanistan. Like, there are some connecting things between us. And I think the conversations, like you asked, are largely about connecting some of those themes, really. And I think after that is also, of course, a more international audience as well. And when I say international audience, I mean beyond the diaspora audience. Of course, we know that the Indian films have collections in Germany, Australia, US, but it's mostly Indians and South Asians only. But how do we make films which are going to transcend that and go to even the other audiences as well? And for that, I think the conversations, one, are the themes of the films themselves. Like, there are certain aspects of our culture which are interesting, and we should I know, we can explore deeper. Like, for example, I remember Vetrimaaran had said in one interview where he was talking about how song and dance is a part of our cinema. Doesn't mean, like, it's a bad thing. We can still use it in a different way as well. So I think it's about capitalizing and understanding what we can contribute there. The other thing also, I think the conversation changes, is that we are used to a certain story-driven sort of cinema in a lot of cases, because it sort of works, I guess. But I think if we are to make films for a global market, we are slowly moving into a more visual storytelling mode, and there's a place that we can bridge as well. Probably, especially in Europe, there's a rich history of cinema. So if we are able to probably tell our stories and engage in conversations, on how to visually represent that and cinematically tell those stories, I think there's something there too.
So let's start with the first film. It happened post the theater tours and then starting the YouTube channel. You teamed up with Vijay Jaipal to make this feature film Nirvana In. And so how did it start and how did the process go? Of course, you might have faced a lot of difficulties while through the film, and what are the challenges faced and how did you manage to get through them for the time? So what are the experiences you have through the film?
I think, just a quick background there. What happened was that after, this YouTube channel happened and then it was just like going nowhere, you're really bored of, having to chase this, number of views and all of that. I just had sent a message to two filmmakers on Facebook just saying, hey, I don't know much about producing generally, but I'm just interested in independent film producing. I've seen your your films, and I think I would like to connect. So I think both of them also were kind enough to say that, we're not really looking for money per se. We want a producer who can work with us. And that's when it really occurred to me as well, more and more, that filmmakers are often looking for producers who are not just, here's a check here. And I think that is the important piece. And I think that's because I also, it's not like I had money in hand. So it's the only thing I could offer was services. So I immediately reached out to them. With Vijay, we watched Revelations, his film again. And then after that, he was working on two other films, which we were developing. And finally, when this was a sort of a genre psychological horror film, immediately that hit it off. With Arun's message, on the other hand, he's invited me to Coimbatore. So I just drove down 7 hours and then met him. And then he took me through Coimbatore to tell me what story he was going to tell. And that's how Naseer happened. So both of them happened pretty much within a short period of a month and a half too. And incidentally, the shoot also happened within a month and a half or two, which eventually became very taxing, because suddenly from doing back-to-back, co-productions also in a very short frame of time. But to answer specifically your question, with respect to every film has its challenges. With respect to Nirvana In, challenges are probably number one, shooting in a place like Manali, in a place that is sort of, so out of, my understanding, was very, very difficult. I understood the value of having good line producers and being able to understand the systems there, because when you can budget whatever you want, but you go there and suddenly a cab is 7,000, 10,000 rupees a day to take people around. Your budget is just going crazy every day and you have to finish within a certain day. Otherwise, everything's fine. It's an independent film at the end of the day, right? Then challenges were we had a very mixed crew. So we had a lighting crew from, Chandigarh. We had a crew from Delhi. We had a crew from Tamil Nadu, a camera crew who'd gone there, and actors. It was just a huge hodgepodge of people from everywhere, and people would fight about things like whether we want chapati today or whether we want rice today. And I don't think it's a bad thing at all. It's just that in -3-4 degrees Celsius, you're just looking to be comforted a little bit, and when people don't have that, people get angry, upset. And people are just really in a tough mood because, it's such hostile conditions to shoot in. So I think these two things were really, really difficult, for sure. I don't think this is the other thing that is difficult. It was new for me working with actors. It was great that we had the likes of Adil Hussain, Sandhya Mittal, and Rajshri Deshpande. It was learning for me in terms of how to work with, actors. Of course, they were accommodating. But it's just that, it requires a different kind of thinking. It's not like your friends, you'll just be in an independent film, we'll just figure it out, accommodation today, things have to be super planned. So those things were also challenging for me to understand. The financing, of course, and thankfully we had very good co-producers as well, who were very understanding. The co-producers also sort of help, but sort of managing expectations between everybody and when there are many people is always very, very hard. And I think if anything I have learned, the most difficult thing is to manage expectations from many people. That I think has definitely taken a toll.
Yes. So regarding budgeting, just now you said that you had a crew from Chandigarh, you had a crew from Delhi, you had a crew taken from Chennai. Of course, Vijay Jaipal has worked with the same camera crew for both the films that he's worked in. So How did you strike a balance between these people, or did you just stay back and let them do their work? Because they are in various departments that we are in, whether it be art or whether it be camera department.
I think you try to just sort of let it flow, especially in this kind of shoot, because it's a very short window. You let it fly till some problem hits the wall. And I think we had two very good executive producers who were there, who were able to sort of like at least, move room to room, to different people, ask them if they're okay, just talk to them, ask them if there's anything special they want. So I think those kind of things were the only things we could really do. Like for example, particularly the Tamil Nadu crew, like were freezing. They're not, I mean, would have never been -4, and then Chennai weather is like so such an opposite, right? So I think they found that very difficult. So we were just like probably getting gloves and getting them something warm, etc. Was things that we kind of helped them with. But I think all of this just boils down to taking the special interest in each of their needs. That's all.
So let's get to Nazir actually. And during Nazir, you have worked with Tarun Karthik, who just when you have said that he's narrated a story to you while taking you on a ride in Coimbatore. So when you work with authors such as Arun Karthik, how did the workflow go? And while shooting in real locations in Coimbatore, I can only think of the number of challenges that could have come every single day with respect to sound, with respect to camera, with respect to many different things. So, yeah, how's it like? You can take one by one.
Sure. So what happened, like I was saying, is that I just sent Arun a message and he texted and said, yeah, let's meet, but I want you to come to Coimbatore, like I said. So I drove down 7 hours, went there. As soon as I got up, Arun's like, come, let's go to this place where I'm staying. And I realized that he had booked a house, I mean, rented a house there. And he'd been living there for the last like year and a half. It was just like a very dilapidated little house. And he's like, put a mat on the floor, like, let's lie down. And like, it's just like, that's it. Just like got straight into it. And then I was like, okay, this is like he wants me to experience that place and wants it. And you can tell the person wants you to experience the things that they are experiencing so that we could be aligned. I really enjoyed that. And then he took me on a walk and I figured that this was a filmmaker who had a very clear understanding of what he wanted to make and a very clear understanding of geography. I was very surprised at the way that he would just like go through between the different locations and he would point out different historical events, different stores. Now, as an example, he would be like, of course we know the communal tensions were there, so he would go to specific incidents saying that in this year this particular incident happened here, this particular time that a person, a certain person was hacked here. So he would just take me through the entire thing and he had a very good sense of that geography. And at the same time, because he makes films only from Coimbatore, he has a very strong sense of like what is there. And I spent about a few days in that ghetto over there. And it's not, I mean, ghetto-ish. So it really opened my eyes to another kind of how cities are. And I guess sometimes you tend to be in your bubbles and then it was nice to be shaken up like that. And working with him, it's like when you know that someone has a clear vision, there's a lot of trust that you just have to place. Like for example, he suddenly called me one day and he said, we have to buy this camera, right? And it was a digital Bolex 16mm digital camera. And I think conventionally people think, no, why do you want to shoot on this? Just shoot on what is there, right? But he's saying, no, this this camera is important. I have this idea of what it should look like. And all of these are leaps of faith. It's not like at that particular moment I knew exactly what it would do. Next day you'd be like, I need a monitor that looks like this. And it's like, okay. But interestingly enough, this is what actually saved the production money also, because we had our own camera, right? So we didn't really need a unit or anything. So this was fantastic. It gives us so much flexibility. It was a small little camera. And of course, beyond that, there were some of wanting to shoot it in a manner where it had that certain quality of image that he also why he needed the camera. But still, those kind of choices are something that I was glad that I partnered on. Besides that, what other things in the film? I think, yeah, besides that, we actually did have a whole lot of fun with the festivals because we had to go to a whole bunch of markets together. So we would always be late. We would always miss our flights. We would always go there last second to pitch. We were like, those last bench people in class, always like just about making it in time. So So we were constantly doing that. But I think through that, we formed a very good relationship of things to come. Now, in terms of production, you were asking me about the permissions, etc. It was very difficult. Thankfully, again, had a wonderful executive producer by the name of Nirmal, who managed to just sweet talk his way into as many locations. It required certain amount of payments, if you know what I mean, to get that done. But and Arun was also specific that he wanted to shoot in certain places. Like one particular thing is, if you've seen the film, you know the store, the sari shop, right? So yeah, so he wanted a sari shop that was not too imposing, but something that would still hold its own in its own market. And we have to shoot live in imagine your, that is like a market area. So you've got to shoot in a market all day, 3 days, just the entire city. So it is hectic, that kind of thing. But we managed to speak to the person, booked it out for a day or 3 days, and people were shopping there while we shot, and it was okay. But it was getting those kind of permissions were definitely tough. The police did help actually a fair bit in being able to, organize some of those locations for us. So I think eventually we're glad that we managed. In fact, the last scene of the film, which is so haunting, it was shot on the last day, and I had to leave as well. And on that particular day, after the film was being shot, the scene was being shot, it was in at about 1:30, 2 a.m. And like people are asleep, right? And there's a group of people that we've got together who will just be shouting in the scene, as you know. So people are shouting and people are open, and there's no permission. So people are just opening the door, like, what is happening? Then shoot it 3 times. And then, it's like third time, like, just better get it right this time. Otherwise, you're going to lose this. And finally, thankfully, they did. But it was a lot of it was just leap of faith throughout.
Wonderful. So both the films that you have made were with filmmakers who have already been in the festival market. So did it become easier to venture into these festivals how did the process begin after making the film for both Nirvanayan as well as Nasir?
No, 100% it helped. And I think their full gratitude to both the filmmakers, because I think if they had not done that part of the first leap, it would have been very difficult to do the rest. So the fact that they were hungry and they wanted to somehow get their films in there, like Revelations for Vijay and Shivapuranam for Arun, the fact they were able to get it there itself is a huge thing, you know. Like, you think about it, you know, without any support, just as a filmmaker alone, you're sending things to festivals, finding programmers and getting your film there, it's super tough. And hats off to them for that, which made my job a lot easier when I started, because I knew that they understood one part of the journey, but I knew that I could quickly figure out the rest. So I think I was able to, from there, use that as a springboard and, build on some of the past connections they had at these markets. Like, for example, because Vijay's film was at Busan before, we managed to apply and Asian Project Market supported our project and we were there. And from there, we also got the Asian Cinema Fund, which actually allowed us to do post-production in Korea as well. So it was good, like being able to, they were built on their work like that. Similarly, because Arun had been in IFFR, we got into Cinemart as well. So both of these, there's a strong correlation between the two.
Wonderful. And for first-time filmmakers, how do you say the Asian Cinema Fund or the Hubert Balls Fund, how are these like, and how do filmmakers go about approaching these ones? Because few of the filmmakers around are trying to make independent films that wouldn't ideally get the theater releases. So how is it like?
Okay, so I think there, I'll just share it from the point of view of the learning that I have had, which is that, first when I heard about the funds and etc., my first question was why, right? Why is someone giving free money? Like, there's still, it's a question, why is there a fund? There has to be some purpose to it. Then you sort of understand that, especially in Europe, film is thought of as an artistic venture, sort of a cultural artifact, right? So for that reason, the government pays for it, right? The government has funds in place to support the cinema as an art form. Similarly, it also has money to help countries which don't have enough infrastructure, or filmmakers who don't have infrastructure to be able to make films. And at the same time, through that, allow employment for their own people, right? By that, I mean services in post-production, etc., which can be done in those countries. Now, with this background, I think we'll have to know, I mean, the first question that we have to ask with our films is that, true, we want to make our independent film the voice that we want, but the fund is also structured in a way that they support certain kind of cinemas, right? It is like, I can't speak for the funds. Of course, they have their own, methods, but it's I would loosely interpret, like, you know, like working with the HPF, I understood that urgent films were very important. A film, is it a story that has to be told now? Is it have something cinematically new and interesting that, you know, we are able to see something that's path-breaking? So they are looking for something specific. So you it is very important that you look at all the fund winners before applying. That is definitely important. But the more important thing I would say is to actually ask yourself, do you need the fund at all? It is a long, complicated process. I remember sitting in a panel where once I was on the other side listening to someone, and they're like, you ask yourself, whether you want to do it? And I was like, of course, easy for them to say, of course, I want to make it. It's difficult. But then I was doing it, I realized it is really, really tough. So a lot of paperwork, a lot of, things that you have to take care of. Now, why I say whether you want it or not is because it's not like there's a misconception that when it's a fund, that they're just going to suddenly write a check and it's going to be like a lot of money in your bank account. It is very far from that. As an example, the HBF NFF is a fund where you need a Dutch co-producer to apply for the fund with you. So first of all, you have to find somebody. That person has to like you. Now that person has to go apply. That person's application has to come through. All of this has to work, has to happen. Then the fund comes. Now, once the fund comes, it is about 50,000 euros. 50% has to be used in Netherlands. Now I have to think of ways to use that. I have to think of, post services, grading, etc. that can be done there. 50,000 euros in India. I mean, imagine, like, let me rephrase. 25,000 euros to do grade in Netherlands can be done for 5 to 10,000 in India, right? It's not, do you really need the money? Sometimes you have to ask. Where it does help, of course, is the stamp, right? Like, knowing that the film has had the Hobbit Balls fund, of course, all allows for a lot more people to see it and visibility for the filmmaker and traveling through festivals. Because, I mean, we are used to a certain, we're not used to, there's a certain limited number of films that are in our purview. Generally, a fund receives so many more. They're like, and a film programmer is flooded with films, like hundreds, thousands of films. If they have to choose, if they see that stamp, they know that it is a film that I want to look at. So in those ways, it definitely helps. So for independent filmmakers, I think for important question asked, do I need the fund at all? Understand the fund, speak to people who've got the fund before and see whether it's working for you. There are certain complexities in the financing which could you need to know in advance. If you have a fund and you also have a private investor, then the private investor should know what the fund is going to do, right? Otherwise, they won't understand why there's another party, why there's another logo, all of that. So you have to be careful with all of those things too. First-time filmmakers, I would say that don't apply without a shot. The most important thing is your previous work. Without your previous work, being applying for any funding or even going to a producer is not a good idea. People are evaluating on your last work for sure, and then your intention with the next film. So both of that have to be in place.
Wonderful. And also the fact that the co-production that you're having, you need to look at it in multiple ways. One, through funding, and also the evaluation that you're getting through that particular name that's associated with it. And so let's look at some channels of distribution now. So budgeting, it's a huge topic. I mean, as you said, it doesn't matter whatever you do, it just goes up and above, and something else happens with budgeting. So you manage to make this film and you do get a help from these funds, so whatever, in whichever way you get possible, or some other private investors, and end up making the film. And let's have two scenarios here. Number one, you get it to the top film festivals. Another scenario where you did not end up sending these films to the top film festivals. What is the scenario like once you have sent it to the top film festivals? What are the distribution channels you have that are opened up because of the festivals? And what happens in the other way around?
Okay. So I just want to address one thing before I jump to festivals, which you had spoken about, the private investors, etc. The key thing here is that when when that be it a fund or be it a private investor, the thing that maybe I wish I had also worked on better with these films, I somehow did it because it was my first time, but I think can be improved, is that it's the structure, right? So ultimately, we don't have the language or the culture to go, no, sorry, we don't have the language or the format and structures to go ask somebody for money. Like if you think of a startup, right? A startup is able to say, we need a seed fund, an angel fund, say a series A, series B, bridge, funding. There's so much language built around financing films. We think that, no, okay, I have an idea. I'll go narrate the idea. I'll get financing, right? This is largely what happens. And then with the assumption is that the person is going to give a full check for the whole money, like the whole film, but nobody's sitting on, always sitting on 5 crores, 10 crores, or even 1 crore, even 50 lakhs like that to give. So they will be like 5 lakhs now, 15 lakhs later. So you have to create structures, like, you know, you have to say that, okay, for three tranches of money, pre-production, a development, and then shoot, and make sure that the cash flow is correct throughout the entire time. I mean, if you have multiple investors, being able to put everybody on the same page so that they all pay the right at the same time. Now, what happens if the film overshoots the budget? What happens if COVID comes for 1 year, right? Every single thing that you can think of has to be in the contract, which is why I would encourage filmmakers to work with producers also. It is good to produce your own, I mean, it is interesting to produce your own film, but these structures are invisible, right? Like when people see the film, they don't know that there is a complex thing that has gone on behind. As an example, even if you're talking about a 2 crore film, right? 2 crores is like a business, right? Like 2 crores are like, you're talking about 100 people who have to get paid, taxes that have to be done. We're going to talk about, so many more permissions, legalities, rights, everything. Doing it yourself is not possible. You have to ideally have a good producer who works, who is able to do all of that for you and not only give you money. Because if it's only money, that I think actually is easier to get than somebody who can actually work on all of this and maximize your film. Now, that's as far as the structures go. And this connects to your distribution question. If I have given X money as a producer, I need to know when I will recoup the money and what I'm going to recoup. For example, traditionally, they build what is called a waterfall model, where they say first, the sales agent will get, next to the next producer, next to the next producer in, you know, pro rata, they'll get their investment. Someone gets a 10% bonus because they came first. So all of these things are there in the finance plan usually. So that structure, I think, is very, very important before, thinking about distribution. So you can always look up waterfall models, etc., and other methods that's done. It's actually not that difficult. The second thing is, like you asked me about avenues for distribution. Theatrical, satellite, OTT, then there's AVOD, SVOD, TVOD, there is festival screenings, which is an important thing, right? And then there is international distribution as well. All of these are different methods of distribution. Now, you'll have to somewhat identify what your major piece is, the major piece that is going to be giving the returns. For example, if you decide, I know there is a filmmaker who's done this, who's made his film on a very small budget, but let's say the screening fee in a festival is about 300 euros. They do 100 festivals, right? 100 festivals into 300 is a decent amount of money, right? So 30,000 euros is the money that you will recoup from that entire, just by screening it at festivals. So, but for that, what you need a festival agent. So you need to prepare for your distribution in advance by creating those pieces. And
Sorry to interrupt. When does this happen? So unless you're a Vetchimaran or an Arun Karthik, you don't end up making the film that you thought of in the first place. So when do you come to this conclusion and say, I'll have an agent for this, or I'll screen it in the festivals, or I'll do it somewhere else, or I'll do it somewhere else? The other distribution model. When do you decide this is the distribution model? And yeah,
good, very good question. Actually, the thing is, I wish I knew all of these things before, and I'm now saying now I feel bad. I wish I thought about some of these things earlier. Which is that you ideally should think about it when you start, because you should at least have a plan, right? A plan A, and then you can change the plan. But to go in blind is a very scary thing. Like, I will never make that mistake again, where my assumption is that, yes, I'll make the film, it'll be in a great festival, And then we'll sell the film. Where? No, OTT. But no, OTT doesn't want means that's it. Now, who wants the film? Nobody wants the film. No one should get caught in those kind of things. Those are the blind things that we do. Sometimes it works. That's the problem. And it's a luck. But you cannot ride on that luck forever. And that blind optimism can affect all of your partners, you know, your work, everything. And of course, the thing is, if you've ever taken debt for your film, it is the worst thing you can do. So I would just, more than anything else, tell everybody, please never, ever, ever, ever take debt for your films ever. You do not, if you can, if it is something you're just quickly going to tide over, fine. But to think that I will, you know, take a loan and make a film and pay it back, forget it, right? Nothing is worth that kind of a hassle. So don't do that. So when do you think about the distribution? At the beginning, have a plan, thinking that, you know, you might do a theatrical for so much. You might have to do so much through satellite. So maybe you will plan to get a presenter, like, you know, Vettimaran Presents, you know, Paranjit Presents, and maybe that will give you something. Think about when you want to partner with them, and maybe early on, you know, and it helps the PR. So festivals are only means to an end. Like, it's not the end. Going to the festival does not give you like the money or like anything back. In Europe, because the films are also paid for by the institutions, the recoupment is not as important as it is over here. Here it's private money. It is somebody's hard-earned money that you're playing with. So if you don't give it back, it feels terrible.
And you were actually saying something else while I interrupted. I'm really sorry about that.
No problem. That's fine.
It's regarding distribution. So yes, regarding Nirvana Inn, it was... post the screenings, it was played on Cinemapreneur, right?
Yeah.
And so what are the various channels that are available like Cinemapreneur? Because on OTTs, you will not end up playing the same film that you have made. Sometimes the original film needs to be compromised, and maybe due to the rules of Netflix or due to the rules of Prime. So when you're working with, definitely Arun Karthik wouldn't want anything to be compromised on his film. So how is it like, and what are the various channels that are available?
So far, I have not experienced the cut from an OTT yet, but I'll have to say yet, because it is going to happen soon, looks like. So every platform does have its own rules, right? Censorship is there in theaters, it's there in satellite, it's there in, you know, OTT as well. So as much as possible, I think, you try to not cut and you fight for it as much as possible, and you make your arguments as the only way with it is to be that powerful and strong in the room to be able to command it. Some filmmakers can make, and we have to work our way to be able to getting there. That's it. So that's what I would say with respect to that. Now, in terms of different modes of distribution, like you said, it's primarily the people go for are your OTT, satellite, there's television, your theatrical, of course. And then now recently there are AVOD and TVOD models. AVOD is advertising VOD, which is like your MX player, which plays an ad in the middle. TVOD is transactional VOD, which basically means that you're paying for every view, right? Netflix and all come under SVOD, which is subscription VOD. Now, you can actually sign rights independently to all of that. Unless your film is really big, it's not like you're going to recover a lot of money from each one, right? So you have to plan which one is going to give you the majority of it. If it's some theatrical, it's great to be able to have some, OTT also will sometimes interested to buy it. Now, with respect to TVOD, you asked me. TVOD, let's say I have a film, I want to put it on Cinemapreneur. They will give me a deal, right? And I don't want to quote the exacts, but as an example, let's say they give me a 70-30 deal or an 80-20 deal. Basically, it means that every ticket bought on Cinemapreneur, they will take 20-30% for hosting the platform. I will take 70% of the ticket sales. Now, the unfortunate thing here is that this is like a box office model, which means that you still have to advertise, right? People are not going to magically come to Cinemapreneur and watch your movie. It's not going to happen. So you have to run like a P&A campaign. You would. P&A campaign is expensive. So again, goes back to the budget and distribution. Have we planned for that marketing and in the beginning? If not, it's true. And that's a mistake that I have made before, where you don't account for the marketing and feels like you'll just, you know, just because when you're in it and you want to make the film, you'll be like, just get the film done. We'll figure out everything later. But what happens is if you don't have any marketing spend at the end of it, you're sitting there with this X crore film with your in your hand, and you're like, I can't spend even 1 rupee more. I don't have 1 rupee to tell someone the film exists. You can't hire a PR person for 25,000 rupees. So you're like, what do you do? So you shouldn't get caught in those kind of situations, so that you keep the money in advance for it, and you're able to plan it out like that. So cinema, I mean, like a TV, TVOD is that. So meaning you do some P&A and it goes out over there. So these are methods, I would say.
Honestly. And regarding marketing, it's a whole new topic that we have ventured into now. So what are the ways of marketing? Earlier, we have known you make a film and you call in press, you pay them a couple of lakhs. They'll all sit there with the cameras and mics, and you sit there with the cast and talk about your film. And maybe audio launches wherein you heap praises about the heroes. Right now, we are working with actors who are hardly known, for once. And two, you can't pay that much money to the press to come and sit to take an interview, which nobody's going to watch because there is no star cast in the film. And how does it work out? What is the marketing that you have followed, and what is the marketing that's present out for indie filmmakers?
So marketing is a hotly debated thing also with independent film, because it sounds like the M word is a bad word, like, you know, marketing. But I think it is just being able to attract the right audience. And while every filmmaker's dream is for everybody to watch the film, the truth is that there is a certain kind of audience who are predisposed to liking your film. And being able to find that first set of people, I think, is really, really important. So here I will actually just start even at the festivals itself. And even, let's say, the final cut of your film is done. Showing it to the right people is very important. And I learned this, that even if you're showing it to three people, the three people have to become your ambassadors, because this is how that effect builds. If you show it to five, just like randomly 20 people, and they don't like it, if the word will start going out, it's not nice. And then suddenly, before you know it, everybody thinks something's wrong with it, right? So you have to control the narrative, at least in the beginning. Of course, like people will have individual ideas, etc. But in this crowded market, you have to give people a frame within what to watch the film, right? And this is a film that I'm watching for that. At least, I mean, you have to give some broad understanding. So in that sense, I always try to make sure, don't show the film too many people, and then it slowly grows. And if it's at the right festivals, from there it grows more and more, and the word of mouth gets better, and people start wanting the film suddenly, right? So building that is important in the marketing. The other is that there are comparable films sometimes, and of course filmmakers hate getting into that, but it helps certain business decisions for some people. What kind of a film is it? It's a bit like this, okay? For if you have to do that kind of conversation, it's important to be able to say it's a film that has the treatment of this, but the visual language of this. So you're able to understand the position it accordingly. And like I said, the first group of people are important. Let's take the example of Nirvana Ayan. We tried to do a marketing campaign for T-Ward, but it was a great learning. Like, for example, we identified different kinds of people who would be interested in the film. One, people from the Northeast, because Adil is there, and he speaks Assamese in the film as well. So it would be interesting to get them to, to talk about it. Two, people who are really, who love independent cinema, right? So this is a small group of people, all the film clubs, basically, who are interested in that. That is number two. Three, genre and horror film buffs, right? So that's the third. So these are different groups. Now you say, okay, let's go after these people and try to get to them. Now, of course, easier said than done. It is very difficult to do without an agency. Like, you have to, you need a group of people to be able to put that together. And thankfully, in our case, everybody, I mean, the co-producers, the director, everybody came together to make that happen. But yes, so I think this is the example of the need for marketing, which is that to be able to find that audience and then engage that audience further. Yeah.
Wonderful. So, and one more question regarding this. This is a personal feeling that Nazir or quite a few films would work really well if it were played in theaters in Coimbatore. Right. People would certainly love them. But
yeah. Even I would love that.
And the nexus of film distribution is working in a way that's you will certainly be able to be help me out in understanding what's the how is it working. Can you spread some light on that?
Even I would love for the film to be shown in Coimbatore, and there the challenges are twofold. One is that, of course, there is a monetary barrier, in the sense that finally, if the film has to be distributed, an exhibitor has to take the risk. they are going to rent their space to you. They are going to distribute the film, put P&A, all of that money behind. Can I for sure tell the distributor that, you know, put the money down, you will make this money back? It's very difficult, you know, that kind of, we don't know yet. We don't know how it's going to happen. So that being able to offset that fear is something that I think has to be done, where maybe I build some P&A in the budget initially to make sure that you exhibit the film, I'll do the P&A. And then I'm able to do, the economics of it also, second, is a trouble, the difficult thing, because, you know, traditionally speaking, you make almost, the producer makes one third of the box office, right? So the distributor and the exhibitor make the rest. So technically speaking, if you let's say I want to make 50 lakhs back on Naseer from the theater, the film has to collect 1 crore 50 lakhs, right? Now, collecting 1 crore 50 lakhs divided by 100 tickets is still 1,50,000 tickets. 1,50,000 tickets is a lot of tickets to sell, right? If I have to, try to get it back. So it's tough. It's tough to be able to, even if I have to say 75,000 tickets, it's a lot of tickets that I have to try to sell. So the economics of the offer also is a little difficult. And I think we have to understand it more and research it more. And what I'm learning now is that we have to do all of this in the beginning, not in the end. The beginning of the film itself, understand the audience, understand the numbers, and try to maximize it. And that, I think, is that's when you're able to do justice to the filmmaker, to the people who are invested, and everybody.
Wonderful. And while you say you're understanding the audience, you're basically categorizing in which all markets you can sell, whether it is to the festival audience, or whether it is to a genre-specific thing, or whether it's to a region-specific thing. Speak about distribution, quite a few films in the recent times have worked this way, that that you send your film to 100 different festivals. It doesn't matter the name of the festival or how big the festival is or whatever it is, but you just put a postcard saying on your trailer, stamp, 100 festivals, and then you take it to maybe names in the industry or to OTTs either present the film or to sell it on OTT. So what is that happening, and what are you doing with your film?
See, the...
It's selling and they're making money.
Actually, I don't feel bitter about it at all. In fact, I'm quite excited that someone is able to do it, in the sense that, ultimately, everybody does what it takes, and we all have to just find ways through everything. And you find your path. And I think I always go, for me in my head, I always go back to independent film. It's like, what is independent film? You're trying to be independent, like, from the conventional structures, right? You're building an alternate avenue. That's what it should mean. So I think it's about building that avenue and owning that avenue all the way through. The concern about people doing this, the festival thing, I think it's short run. I mean, ultimately, people know now. People are always learning. So now people know 5 festivals in the top 5. Oh, it's good. If this newspaper is covering it, this is a good festival. So people are learning a few things about it. So I don't think it's a major worry in that sense. The fact that they're able to put someone and package it and do it is their skill. And I think it's great. And something that I think independent, we all should learn as well. In that ability to be able to, that it works, and also take it to the audience too. Ultimately, we want the audience to see the film. And I think sometimes, making the film is not enough. The story of the story of the film is really important. And the producer's job is to tell that story of that story in whatever way possible to get it to that audience.
Wonderful. And let's go back to the story now. And when you say that you would like to tell storytelling through cultures, cultural storytelling, as well as you have a background with user interface, which can be very much related to films, actually. It's still another user or a particular viewer who's watching the film, and every single frame is something that's being created for a user to experience or view. So how does that play a role, and how does the culture, how does all of these three things play a role together while you're selecting the stories and while you're making the film?
So I was lucky that, just by pure accident, and some chance, I mean, some planning, I guess, I studied user interface design and user experience engineering, which largely means that you are designing systems around a particular user, which goes to say that, any technology that is being built today, like an ATM, like for a rural village, anything, is all being built in such a manner that you design for the psychology of that user, right? So that's what user experience is. What I learned from it is that you can understanding the audience, that empathy, right? So it may sound like you're engineering the ATM for that villager, but actually what you're doing is that you are designing with some level of empathy so that that person can use it. So similarly, every single thing in the film is also like that. Can you empathize with the filmmaker's point of view? Can you empathize with what they want to say? Can you empathize with the audience and what they want to hear, see? So there is this is that building of empathy is one thing I definitely learned. Number two is that UX is a highly stakeholder communicative sort of space. In the sense, if I want to design that screen, I need to talk to business, marketing, your engineer, developer, like 10 people in the room. I need to make happy before I make that decision and tell everybody that this is what the user wants. Similarly, in this. The project is your film. There's an objective that the film is, it has to be made. You have to now speak to your co-producers, your sales agents, your filmmaker. Everybody has their perspective, and you're in the middle trying to connect everything to make sure that the filmmaker's film is vision is translated and the film can have its maximum potential. So these two things were the big learnings from design. But beyond that, I think also being in a design community for a long time, it gave me access to understand aesthetics a lot more. Right, so all the conversations that we have about inclusion in cinema, or rise of different gazes like female gaze or Dalit gaze, all of these things are all things we're talking in design as well, right? So in many ways, it sort of informs these discussions, and I feel more confident being able to speak to filmmakers. Because I think the only way to gain a filmmaker's trust is by outworking them. You have to do more than them, and that's the only way they can trust you, right? Otherwise, it's tough.
And so it's obvious that you run into misunderstandings, and there can be evenings where you and the co-producer have a fight, and the co-producer and the director have a fight, and the art director and the director, usually every day they have a fight. And while doing all of this, what are the basic ground points or the ground rules that you set, just so that no matter what happens, we'll come back here and this is what we started out for, or something like that, just to make sure that you're making everyone happy at the end of the process, not necessarily at the end of the day.
So I've been fairly diplomatic. So for a long time, I somehow managed that. But in hindsight, I don't think I was very successful with it in both the films. I think it goes back to actually making it very professional, in the sense that everything boils down to some sort of an agreement or a contract, right? And it is if you have a fight and a person leaves, there has to be some sort of repercussion to that. If a person has an obligation to fulfill, there has to be that as well. So I think in a way, we have to be able to, I mean, I would love the romantic idea of everybody getting together and just making it, but ultimately it's true. Even for an independent film, some loose codes of conduct have to be put in place. And I would say that is probably in my mind the only the major way by which it can be done. Besides that, I think it's certain things from now on. I mean, you have to think there's no place for brilliant jerks anymore. If someone is being horrible to people on the set and they're still, nobody deserves to be yelled at and shouted at and anything like that. So if any of that is happening, or if that person is that kind of a person, at least personally, I would say you don't have to work with them. I mean, there are thousands of other people, right? You don't have to tell that person's story. So it's okay. Like, I think those things we need to get over. There's no room for, we shouldn't cut slack for people who are harassing and who are, making life difficult for other people. So I think as long as you eliminate those bad apples, sometimes, things just work out well. So ultimately, I think it also boils down to, from the beginning, are we all aligned in the same vision, right? If you are not, then it's okay. Then it's a bad combination. In fact, I often think, the why is so important. Why is everybody making that film, right? Because if everybody's clear as to why, because we want to tell this story, we're passionate about telling the story on the deepest, darkest day, right? On the day that you are so down and out, maybe you're broke, maybe you've had a breakup, maybe you're like haven't slept in 3 days. When you look at yourself, like, why am I, you know, you think to yourself, why am I doing this? You will say, you know what, I'm doing this because I want to make this film, right? And if you don't have your why sorted before you start, it's always very shaky, I think.
Very true. And so let's take it light and let's hear out what are your future projects before we get to some more serious conversation again.
Sure. As far as, I mean, like I said, I've taken on this new role at the Story Culture Company, and it is I'm currently building a accelerator, which is a film and series accelerator, which will be a system of, let's say, 6 to 8 months where projects can come in, go through development, find, and all the things we spoke about, you know, taking audience insights and being able to, you know, help the filmmaker with, you know, with their development of the project. This could be through, you know, maybe some kind of music they want to collect. Maybe there's something else they want to research around the film, to the actual writing process through international mentorship, and finally through to distribution. So building this accelerator now, that's my next plan with the Story Culture Company. And as far as projects that Disha and Tarana are taking care of with Stray Factory, that is, there is a film that they are writing and it's being produced this year. It's I can't say too much because the signing is almost on, but it's an exciting director. It's an exciting actor turned actress who's turning director for this film, hopefully. And it's going to be, it's also about a very hotly contested social topic. So it'll be quite interesting to watch.
Wonderful. And coming to political films, now that you made a political film and are going to make a political film again, what is the challenge like, again, to get the distribution and also while making the film, to align everyone on the vision that this is a political film? Because people usually can be biased themselves, but the film takes on this vision of being political. So how is it like? And yeah, mainly stress on the distribution, if you can. Making a political film here in India, and it's, I don't know how hard that is or how is it happening to...
I guess, you know, this again goes back to the why question, no? Because if you're somehow everybody is clear that they have a political point of view and they want to be able to share it through cinematically. And once you're aligned on that, you don't care. Everybody's just doing it because they just want to do it. And after that, everything else becomes secondary. But as far as right now, things are scary. I think personally, for me, I feel like it is scary, especially with OTT censorship, etc. I do find it like absolutely ridiculous that we have to, you know, think so much about it. And also, it's unfair that there is a certain kind of, you know, self-censorship now, right? Now imagine every filmmaker is thinking to themselves, oh, like if I talk about this, then maybe I can't sell my film. Okay, I won't talk about it. That's not what we want to do, right? So this, the worst form of censorship is self-censorship, and we are like now in that world. So that I think is terrible, which is why, if anything, now is the time to make political films. So and political films are different from propaganda films, right? So I'm of course not saying that it should have no nuance at all. We are, in a democracy like ours, we should be allowed to be able to have a point of view through our cinema and engage with people. And I think as far as the distribution piece you go, you ask, that's like anybody's guess. I think you just blindly make and hope. And I don't have a clear answer because of course, with all of this censorship that is running. But people are succeeding to make these films, right? But the only thing I will say, though, is that it is important for it to be seen, because sometimes, you know, so much work and pain in making a political film, and then it's just like there for a few people to see. That's not good. I mean, otherwise, of course, everyone just watch it on Telegram. I know that. But I mean, that doesn't help the filmmaker. It doesn't help us make more movies. So if you watch it on Telegram, at least donate to us.
Do you have something that we can discuss about? I'm not sure I have any other questions.
I think I was happy to sort of discuss, these pieces. I hope some of it, is useful for new filmmakers who are
Sure.
Do it. I think if I wanted to stress on, especially I believe that at least some folks who may watch this are early young filmmakers and first-time filmmakers. The thing is, one, never take on debt. I think that is number one rule for sure. Number two is like, just always think whether you need the funds, etc. That's really, you have to find different, there are, don't have to get too carried away thinking that, you know, every film has to get some funds from some country and all that. That's two. Three is that I think the why is the most important thing with the film. Like, you know, if, yeah, and I think a good, every producer is actually just looking for that. And they're not, they're looking for how, you know, what is the motivation for making that film? Is it just, if it's only self-sustaining and it's only for yourself, then, you know, there's not much you can do with it. And I think last piece is that it's important that we look at all the things related to marketing, audience insights, everything in the beginning itself, distribution, answer all the questions at the beginning, watertight contracts, and then move ahead. And if you have to get an accountant or a lawyer, get it. So it's important. It's equally important as much as everything else in the film.
Hi, Mathi. Nice to hear you talk about the nuances of indie film distribution and all. Yeah, so I wanted to know, like you mentioned that in every screening, you know, say a film goes to 100 film festivals and earns €300 from each screening. So, like, is there any set rule that, okay, you know, like, is there any opportunity to just screen films in film festivals and earn from them, just them itself? Like, I'm sure, like, not all festivals have that thing that, you know, you can earn from them. It's mostly for viewing.
Got it. So it's a good question because I think there's a lot of mystery that's like generally shrouding the film festival world in general in terms of how to liaison with them. The thing is, if you have a film, if it's a short or a feature, mostly the festival is supposed to give you either something like accommodation, flight, or a screening fee. Usually, if it gives you the screening fee, you have to forfeit your travel, right? Or you have to forfeit your what they're going to give you, the pass, etc. Now, not all of them have the, not all festivals have the budgets for this. But there are now good enough festivals that will do it. So maybe a way to do this is that in your budget, submission to festivals could be an important thing as well, right? So you're sending it to enough so that you can make through this. But then again, let's remember that you have to target certain kind. If it's a genre film festivals. If it's a children's film festivals. So being able to do that makes it important, makes it happen. And €300 is an example for some premium films. Not premium, but like mid to premium. But sometimes it could be 50 or 100. So it is possible to do it. But another thing is it's a lot of work. So it's good to maybe sometimes have a festival agent. And there are people who do this. But, you know, it's also great to just learn, you know, oneself, how it works, right? And ideally done by the producer, not the director, because the directors go mad doing this every day. So I also noticed the directors tend to be a little more, you know, think like their film can be accessible any festival, like let's send. But I think as a producer, you like sometimes can be afford to be a little more detached and say, you know, I think these are the festivals that we should send it to, etc. So yeah, so I hope that answered the question.
That's right. Yeah, it does. Thank you.
My question is actually, I've just done a filmmaking course and I'm exploring movie making. So I am actually coming from a background. Before this, I was a social designer. So I thought than the writing medium, the film medium would make more sense in expressing what I wanted to do the intervention, because I basically do it for the people and they must know it. So that's why I have started with this. But my vision of it is like right now I've made movies which are near my community, because since it's pandemic and I had taken a 6-month course, so there Arun Karthik came as a kind of for a guest session, because it was a course by R.V. Ramani. So
okay.
So then I came to know about you, that's how I came here. But my question is, now when I make a movie, my first thing is I show it to my family and the immediate community where I have shot, because that makes sense for me. But it's a very small community, but they were actually very much amazed by what I shot, because that is not what they see, but I saw what I saw and they saw is different. So I thought to move forward, it's just a 5 to 10 minute movies now I made, and I wanted someone to fund, because basically the next level would be I can show it to my institution, which can support me or may not support me, because there are many reasons, right? Like how we are saying, it may be thought in a political angle where I did it for a personal thing and other things. So that is the second thing. And the third is when I asked to my mentor, he just said, you can send it to film festival. That's the way. But what I feel is in a film festival, even you're sending a single movie for every entry they charge. And it's like too much of things they ask. Like you must have a 2-year experience. You must put your portfolio. You have to put your other movies, what you have made. So these things make me like, I'm just starting to explore and want to tell people this is what I've done and they should know it. Not a bigger sense of like I need this or that, but how as a new filmmaker who adventured from some other field to this field, just to reach out to people what I wanted to do. Not too many, but to the right people, like how you mentioned. To the right people it should go so that it can proceed further better. So I thought if I have to make something bigger on the same thing, which I have ideas, I've scripted and kept, but I need funding, then how can I approach? Because I don't have experience. It's just 6 months, but then my research experience of 7 years is a part of it, where I do photo kind of movies and writing kind of thing. And it's an extension of the same. It's not that I don't have this, but all things make it together. So I just want to ask you how I can approach this.
Okay. So from what I understand, there are two pieces here. One is actually the where to take the films themselves and scene. Yeah. And two is the actual funding piece as well, right?
Yeah, if I have to make it a complete film, it's just a part of the film which I have made out of my budget and out of my limitation. But then my vision would be different, which needs some kind of support to make my vision into practical. So that's the thing.
Sure, sure. So I think as far as the getting the film seen piece, I think that's the piece where, like, you know, I've also realized that every film, every filmmaker, they have a tribe, right? They have a certain group of people that the film will attract. The tough job is in actually identifying what that tribe is, and actually sometimes we're very blind to what it is. As an example, like you may be thinking that your film is about entrepreneurship, but actually maybe the film is about what is attracting people is that it's this gender issue on it. So maybe what happens is that then a lot of the gender festivals, etc., pick it up. So sometimes to identify which tribe that the film can take it forward is important. There you can actually approach, like, for example, doesn't have to be the film community. See, sometimes, like, there are organizations like you have your Alliance Française, Goethe Institute. There are a lot of people in these communities who do the screenings as well. And there are important people who come for these screenings. So I think it is important to find your tribe through those methods. And I think ideally it's better if a producer does it, or if you have one person who can help you with it. See, you need one person to be detached from the film a little bit, right? Right, and that definitely helps. So for first step, yes, the tribe. And as far as the film festivals go, like, it's good to learn and go through with it, but I understand it's like one crazy world, right? Yeah. So always look for other films like yours, which have been at the festival. That is comparable, as they say. If your film is like this other film, you can do it. And since you're in the social design space, I would say people, places like Srishti or like, design school in NID or, you know, places like that, you know, it would be interesting to send it to faculty and say, I have this film, would you be interested? You know, you never know what kind of connection. The thing is, it's so funny that somehow this tribe, once it opens up, it'll open 100 other things suddenly, right? So I know this from another filmmaker who went through this, where she had a film, it is about social entrepreneurship, and then suddenly, another director's calling, some other festival suddenly have found interest. It's because people talk, people are in a certain tribe, so they always speak and this is flowing. So find that and they run it, that is one. As far as the funding piece goes, there's no easy way out for this, of course. And I would think that actually the only thing I would say is that find a structure within which you can get financed. Like if you generically say, I want to make the film and this is the budget, it becomes very difficult. You need to maybe make a plan and say, this is my total budget. I need this much to get started. So now once you get started, you do the first pilot. Now you say, I got a pilot. Now I need more. And you get, so you slowly build the film like that. I think that is a better way. And first film, mostly it's going to be friends and family. There is no doubt. Yeah. And best to just rely on that and then go ahead for the first one.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, Mathi.
Yes.
I'd like to trouble you for just one more question.
Sure.
So this is regard to the theatrical distribution for independent films. So, like, I think you might know that in US, they have these this technique where, you know, they release it in limited number of theaters, such as maybe some 50, 60 or 100 something. And with regard to that response, they then expand to more number of theaters. This is mostly for independent films. So is it possible in India? Does it happen actually?
It has not happened as much as it should, but it does. Like Ibaliyu had a small theatrical as well. Sir had a theatrical run. Tithi had a decent, very good theatrical run. So there are films that do it, but the thing is, my feeling is that there is a gap in the marketing distribution ecosystem a little bit. For example, if you take a film, a company like A24, they're able to take like very offbeat films, market it insanely, and get it seen in the theaters because they know who the audience is. They're able to get it there. Here, the films are small and we're up against some huge giants everywhere that we are not able to hit that mark yet, right? And if there was a company that was able to package these films coolly and, you know, have ads running on all of your, digital channels, having TikTok reels, whatever, finding some cool way, like, you know, banner ads, etc., to come and watch it, people will. But I think that's the big gap. This is possible. Also, the economics of the theaters are a little tough because, the theaters can't, have big films coming in the middle and they can't keep this independent film in the middle if it's not filling up seats. And unfortunately, exactly. Independent films require time to be filled up. So there's a challenge there too.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Thank you.
I have a question here. Nowadays, most of the films are made in Tamil, Telugu, or any other language, are remakes or dubbed. Does the production distribution cost increase? If so, what about the expected returns? I haven't worked in this section too much, so I can't speak to it too much, unfortunately. If you're asking about the production expense increasing because of dubbing, my guess is that actually the distribution of that through satellite, etc., is exponentially more than the dubbing cost. So I think usually that is fine. The remakes, I'm not too sure, unfortunately. Unfortunately, I wish I could have answered your question, but I have to confess that I don't know.
I have one more question to ask. I don't know, it's respect with your field, but then this is like, I had a concept in mind, which is a fiction, and then I made a trailer and presented in my class course. And then I did it based on my sense of kind of a fantasy and based on nature. But ultimately, the comments I got was it was more of kind, I should venture into animation and it's a kind of a science fiction. And my question is, when I had the concept in mind and I had a month's time, I just shot what all could be. And the other things I wanted to do with animation, but since I didn't have a software, I actually made it in my charts and then I moved the camera and made it as a movie. And that was like good. But then for such kind of movies, like if I have made just a trailer and I have to make a movie, then how can I go for funding for such kind of something experimental? I can't call it animation also, but it's actually a kind of things where scenes where I don't find I have to actually create in my charts. And things which I find it, I take it up by shooting. So how can I deal with such things? And how can I even propose such things and ask for a kind of a funding or things? Because I can't put it under even a box, like what it means my movie is about.
I think that's the important thing there is that the only past work can help people understand future work. No? So if you're, even if you are able to demonstrate this in 1 minute, on Instagram, it still counts. Like, I think it's about finding something small that you can show, build on it. If you look at every filmmaker, that's what it is. They start off with the film. The film becomes bigger, and they make something because the people are convinced of the vision by then. So I think you need a pilot or like something small to start, which is why I think, especially for filmmakers, I think the first film or first short film is really important because if you get too much feedback and your thought process is a little corrupted, you're confused, it becomes difficult. Yeah. You have to make something that is honestly yours. And then after that, you can be like, okay, this is the mistakes I made. This is what I couldn't do. And you build on it continuously. So I think that's really important.
Thank you.
Sure.
So thank you for the session today. And it's really informative. So hope to see you again.
All right. Thank you very much, Shanmugh. Thanks, Whitebird Trails. Thanks for having me. Yeah? And thanks for all the questions.